Good afternoon. We are delighted to be here to honor our alumni fellow for the College of Veterinary Medicine. And I'm not afraid to say, last night we met with all the alumni fellows on campus, and our alumni fellow is best. He's number one among those fellows, most accomplished. I was so proud to introduce him last night to the other deans of the other colleges and all the other alumni fellows. His name is Dr. J. Merriam, and he's a 1969 graduate of our college, and some of his classmates came to be with him here today. So I want the students to think about that. This is 54 years after graduation, and his classmates have come here to spend time with him. Do you want to just take a minute and introduce your classmates? Tell us who's here.
The white hair is Dr. R.J. Gump, yeah. From Wichita, Victor Anspaugh, Joni Williams, your classmate, Joni. Who else is up there? Oh! Who is that? Oh, that's Justin. Justin Jansen, and Mary, of course, and John Phillips. Did I miss anybody? Anyway, I'm so touched to have them here, and then to have Dean Bonnie and Sharon and all the other support staff. Joan, thank you.
So. Yes. And so I think he's going to tell his story, so I don't want to steal his thunder and have too long an introduction, but I'd like to share with him, for the students in the room and the faculty, how many of you would like or are intending to work on horses in the future? This is a question for the dean as well. The dean is interested in this question. Raise your hand if you are interested in working on horses in your future. Yeah, as you know, it's the most important species that we teach here at the College of Veterinary Medicine. And there is no more accomplished equine veterinarian for the whole range of equids, meaning from secretariat to the most loved, well-loved 30-year-old donkey. There is nobody who has more experience with the range and breadth of horses. And so I'm just going to, I need to give him a gift, and then I'm going to finish my introduction.
Oh, wow. Look at this. This is the kind touch. This is wonderful. Boy, I know where that's going to go. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Now I'm on. Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce to you Dr. J. Merriam, global hero.
Thank you, Dean Bonnie, for that kind introduction. And today is going to be a little bit different view of the profession we all love and are going to love, are going to be part of. And it's going to be a little bit high speed. There's going to be a lot of cases, a lot of interesting things, but we're probably not going to talk about them. I want to talk to you about the ride I've been on, the ride my wife, Shelley, who I met here in 1969, been with me the whole way. So how did it begin? Come on, Dusty, let's go. Dusty's my little cow horse I bought when I was 15, and he changed my life, literally changed my life. The other person in this picture is my grandfather, who graduated from West Point in 1904 and was a mounted officer for 35 years in the United States Army. He knew a bit about horses too. So that's me, and that's my darling wife, Shelley. And I'm going to talk to you about some things that we have done, unconventional veterinary medicine, if you will. We've had a practice, we've had the normal trainings and things like this, and we'll go through that, but there are some things that stand out, some things that we consider very important, some things that have shaped our world and I hope will shape yours. The three names there were Project Samana, the Equitarian Initiative, and the American Fondue, and I'll explain each one of those. But this is a journey. This is a ride from little old Apple to the world, and it's a ride you can all take, and I want you to come along with me and see what's going on. Homage to a couple of my classmates, Mark Williams, Turkey, Bill Gallen, and myself on the day of graduation, just to prove that we actually graduated. A couple more guys at Cattown, Ron Sanko, Curtis Ish, and me, we've come back periodically. And my family, my loving family, daughter and son, Marnie and Todd, here we are in Spain, I think. We spent a lot of time together traveling, doing fun things. And there's the class of 69 at 50 years. The guy in the big hat is Justin Jansen, who is a mentor to many of you here. He wasn't in our class. He's in a class of his own. So, Shelley and I got married in 1971, and the journey began. Well, it was a little exciting, the first honeymoon, 6 weeks in Europe, but we knew we'd never be back in a reasonable time, so we did it. So I want to start with this premise. It's pretty easy to read. Wherever man has left his footprint in the long road from barbarism to civilization, we will find the hoofprint of the horse in it. And there's nothing more true in my life than that. I want to show you a little bit of the path. I don't expect you to read all this, but they told me when we were starting to set all this up, oh, just make a note of the things you've done, places you've been, and So if you want to read it closely, I'll get a copy to you. But we've had an interesting career, a long way from Bonner Springs, a long way from the Little Apple. I want to talk first about equine practice. That's what supported all of my endeavors, is equine practice. And I worked on many, many world champions of different breeds. This is my favorite. Of course, named Lamborghini in black. He's a world champion, multiple world champion, Morgan Park saddle horse, and was very, very influential in my work with Morgan's. But he's a world champion. Here's a real world champion. I don't even know his name. He may not even have a name. But this donkey is supplying transport to this family. These buckets were full of milk that Luis had extracted from a cow out in the pasture behind you and had taken to the dairy, and on the way back he picked up some grain. This is the real world champion right here. This is the horse that moves the world, or the equid that moves the world. I want to talk a little bit more about my practice just to show that, in fact, I did practice. Began to limit my practice after the racetrack and the surgery training to performance-limiting conditions. And in fact, that was what my specialty was, sports medicine. They say home and practice can be hard to combine. This is our home on the right, the practice on the left. The commute was a bitch, but it was doable. When we finished up and sold this practice 10 years ago, I was the token male in an 11-person office. So it's been quite a ride. I worked on all sorts of performance horses. There is no reason to limit yourself. A horse is a horse, is a horse, is a donkey, is a mule, is a horse. But performance is the big deal these days, and we want to know about limiting performance and how do you treat jumpers versus drivers versus standardbreds and dressage horses and their horses. And as you go through this little ride I'm taking on, you're going to see that there are other parts of the horse world that perhaps we need to pay attention to. Working equids is the broad term for horses, donkeys, and mules. They indeed move the world. They're visible in transport, water, commercial, agricultural goods. They take kids to school. They take people to the doctor. They take people to commerce in many ways throughout the world. They plow the fields, they pull the carts, they carry rocks on their backs, these poor little burros. Why should we care? just because we're veterinarians and we're altruistic and we're nice people. Yeah, we should. Those are all good. We should also care because they move the world. We must be concerned about the families that these 110 million horses support. Working equids in the developing world are 10 times the number of horses we see in the Western world. And yet they're neglected. 1% of them might get some veterinary care. So my message to you today starts with you, meaning you, can in fact help these animals and in turn help this lovely world that surrounds us. Give back. You, especially you, new to the profession, are in the process of acquiring a healing gift. You are going to be healers if you are not already. That's a gift that needs to be shared. That's a gift that the world needs more than ever. And the fact that you're healing animals that then help heal and support families is so key and so fundamental. So you can make a difference. A week a year, 2 weeks a year, you don't have to be Mother Teresa. You can go wherever you want. These are students from Tufts that I was taking on the a trip to the Dominican Republic. We'll talk about more. The guy on the right up there looking at me drill out a hoof abscess with a power drill is a former president of the AAP, John Mitchell, who's been with me many, many times. Around 1993, Shelley and I and a friend of ours from Massachusetts, which is where our practice was based, formed a relief organization called Project Samana. And it's named after the Dominican Republic, a little area in the Dominican Republic that needed a lot of help. Very rural, very agricultural. Horses still move coconuts, which is what they're doing here. Bananas, and we decided as a group that our Massachusetts Veterinary Medical Association needed to reach out, and we were asked to reach out, and that's key. We'll talk a little bit more about that. So, the Dominican Republic is the second poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, exceeded only in its poverty by Haiti, right down the street. The little red peninsula is the peninsula of Samana. We chose it because we were invited there and also because it's pretty easy to get around in the peninsula and take a measure of what you've done, how much you've helped, what's going on. So we started going to this little place where coconuts, cacao, and tourists were the basis of an economy. Every family in the rural area had a donkey or a horse. I was overwhelmed. This is my second case on the second year that we had been there on a scouting trip. This guy has got a scrotal hernia the size of a basketball. And right in here, the bruja, the local witch, has been letting air out of it every week with a knife. So that's what we were presented with. This horse was the sole support of his family because he had to pack coconuts. You can see his skin and bones. Couldn't work. The family's in trouble. I've done a lot of scrotal hernias in my practice. They're always on well-kept, well-fitted racehorses who popped a button. I've never seen anything like this in my life. But you're there, you have the skills, you got the stuff, you got a couple of professionals who are going to help you out. There's no reason not to do it, so we did. Oh, there's other surgical challenges. This guy walked the horse 2 days to get to our clinics. They knew we were coming. I'm still not sure what that was. It, probably a squamous cell. But again, the biggest amputation I've ever done. And successful. We put the horse down last year from old age. We did a couple of operations on him. I should stop just a moment. My wife says not concentrate on castration too much. We do a lot. Team Rompegranos, ball buster in Spanish. The Rompegranos team, we are using a drill to to take the testicles off. And there we go. It bleeds almost insignificantly. Very, very useful in the third world. A couple of scenes around Samana. This is a family we got to know really well. I know their grandchildren now. This is their donkey. He's been out by the beach waiting for them to fill it up with fish and bring it back to the market. This is our coordinator, Kim, who is a Canadian who helps us coordinate with the locals. These guys are just coming back from the field. Up here on top is something I'm very proud of, picture of a guy who is doing what we call chop and carry. They don't have hay fields down there, but we convinced them that if they would just plant some king grass and watch it grow an inch or two a day, they could chop it, carry it to their horses and feed them and make them healthy. And in fact, that's what happened. Oh, let me back up one. Mentoring is part of our deal. Each of our trips is loaded with students, vet techs, young vets. We try to set up a lab down there. We try to set up, we do a small animal team as well. But this is part of our group. This is the equine group. Here, the woman in the lime green shirt graduated from K-State 10 years ago, Catherine Fertig, and she's in California now. The guy with the beard is Steve O'Grady, who was an international veterinary podiatrist who's been with us 7 or 8 times, donating his services to the poorest animals in the world. So this is what we do, mentoring. You know this guy, he hasn't been on the team, but I think he's gonna come. He's mentor number one. We could see that the way he plays basketball. He doesn't look, he just fires. And you have learned, because he's told you, be ready. And that's what I'm gonna tell you. This is what my mentor will tell you. Those balls are going to come out fast. Be ready. Shelley is the best technician I've ever had. And at home, in our practice, she never worked on animals. But in the third world, she was a mentor to all, a mother to all. And again, that's what we do. Very important. The new generation, especially in Latin America, of equine vets, or vets in general, is just like here. It's you lovely women. Even though they are against a very strong, male-dominated Latin culture, when we go down and defer to them, they become important. They become the reason that the project is successful. These young women are both, this is our original veterinarian, Dr. Ileana de Gonzalez, who is the one who invited us down there. She has a grown daughter now who is also a veterinarian. Oscarina Mendez, her father is a veterinarian at one of the vet schools and he helps us with large animal stuff. Carrie McColgan is now president of Project Samana, which is a freestanding nonprofit organization. She was a student at the time. So the students in action get a lot of stuff. I want to tell you about, you know, coming from Kansas. I grew up a lot with a lot of the guys with the big belt buckles, you know, the ones that really could rope and really could ride. If any one of them could ride one mule and lead 6 at a gallop down a lane, have them stop right in front of me, and then, stand off and look at him for orders, they get a bigger belt buckle. This guy is a genius. And these mules are not house pets. But he comes to see us every year because it helps his business. It helps his livelihood. It helps his family. And that's why we're there. It provides security. The big word here, the big green word, sustainability. You've heard about sustainability. There are colleges that offer degrees in sustainability. I don't have any idea what that means. Sustainability in the world of charity, the types we run, is a fantasy. If you think that these people are going to soon be able to take care of all their medical needs without us, you're wrong. Someone who lets $15 a day for packing coconuts is not going to suddenly buy a castration and pay a vet to come up and do it. Sustainability to me means as long as we sustain the flow of education, resources, money, knowledge, and personnel to these projects, they will in fact grow and be sustained. But they will not ever be self-sufficient, and I think that's pretty important. Human and equine welfare, as I've told you already, are very much entwined. Working for the good of the horse is working for the good of the family. This is not a biker gang. These guys are waiting for a tourist bus. Every one of these guys, and we'll show you a little bit in a minute, will then hop off his horse, put an overweight American tourist on it, and take it for a ride through the countryside to either a beach or a cascada, a waterfall, or some scenic spot, and he in turn will get his $15 for doing that. Somebody else will get $75 from the tour agency for arranging this and giving the people a little bit of a comida tipica. So it's an interesting dynamic. But you can see these horses are looking pretty good. We've been taking care of these horses for years. They didn't look so good. And I just want to say it's not all work. It's not all tears and seriousness. We have an awful lot of fun down there with these. We've got veterinarians that have been going with us, same folks for 15 or 20 years. Every once in a while, we're presented with the impossible. We were there where Celeste was carrying that big load of worm medicine. We were there to drop off some worm medicine. They said, oh, by the way, would you look at this? Happened a week ago, and they knew we were coming. How long does it take one of those things out? With a three instruments that we had available and a few helpers, we got it out in about 10 minutes. So there he is, or she is, all bound up, ready to go, and we're on our way to the next stop. 1 year later, almost to the week, I picked her out of that lineup. And there she was, back to work, one eye, doing her best. And this is the lineup, the same guys that we showed you before, waiting for a busload of tourists. So we made a difference. We made a big hit. Building trust in the community is more than just saying, I'm coming down and do a lot of good work, things are going to be fine. Building trust is having Shelley go around and become, before too long, the hero of the village. Every year, before digitals, we would go down and she would, with her extreme knowledge of Spanish, say, hola, hola, foto, foto. She would take pictures of all the kids in the village. And the next year, we would promise them that we would come back with the photo. And invariably, we did. And they are all holding their photo. The thing is that they couldn't pick out their own photo because they don't have mirrors. This is how different things were then. So we would go from village to village, pass, and they'd say, oh, you're the vet. Where's your wife? You know, it's we want our pictures. But it's building trust. Most of these people are now adults, and we still see them, and they still have their pictures. So it's the little things that help build trust. Here we are in our 30th year. The veterinarian with the funny hat on there on the right is a guy from Ireland. He's from the Donkey Sanctuary. He came over and joined us every year for 5 years. We've brought people in from all over the world to come and see this work and to help us out. And again, Shelley and her little fan club. The key here, see the big 3-0, we're back. Every single year, the same time we showed up. USAID and other government agencies, a lot of times, are not quite that careful. Here's your tractor. We'll see you in 10 years. Oh, you needed gas? It didn't work? Too bad. Show up. Go again and again and again. You can't spread yourselves too thin and save the world, but you can sure as hell save a corner of it. And that's what we're up to. Oh, another little cute story. This kid's riding across the field, singing to his donkeys, packing coconuts. This is going to be picked up at the end of the day, and his family will get credit for probably $20 worth of coconuts. The donkey is blind and responds to voice commands. that's what we're up against. That's what these people are up against. And the kid is happy. The donkey is happy. The donkey's leading a good life. We warm him. We take care of him when we see him. It's a different world. We started a mule breeding program down there, which is just been the most enlightening thing. People didn't realize. They thought they had to go buy mules because they're so expensive. And if you just take that scrawny little jaguar, that scrawny little mare, and breed her to a nice little jack, you'll get a mule that you can be proud of. You can carry tourists all day with these things. So we did that. So that's Project Samana. And there's, you know, I could go on and on and on forever, but because of my work in Samana, because of my work with the AAP, I was getting a little bit known as the welfare guy. So HSUS sent me to Haiti 10 days after the earthquake in 2010. Had no idea what we could do. They said, just take a team down there, assess it, do what you can do, and let's see. Well, I've never been to Haiti, number one, never been to an earthquake like this. And all I can say is the smell of 200,000 souls wandering through the air was something I'll never forget. But the animals were actually fine. Well, if a Haitian animal is ever fine. His owner, however, has every bit of her possessions on his back. We met her at the dump. And this is a dump you may remember. Anderson Cooper came down to a week later and found 50,000 bodies buried in that dump. But this is where she was. The animals are so critical in a situation like this. We as veterinarians can give direct aid to the animals. We collaborate with like-minded groups. We educate our Haitian colleagues and their clients, and we do small projects. You don't have to save the world. This is not the Mayo Clinic. The interesting thing is that people are flying food into Port-au-Prince, so much that the airport had to shut down because they didn't have a landing space for all these planes. You go 10 miles out of Port-au-Prince, there's more food than you could eat in a year. It's separated from Port-au-Prince by roads that are crumbled, and only a donkey could carry it. And it took a long time for us to persuade some of the aid groups. You could start a donkey caravan here and carry fresh fruit into Port-au-Prince, where they're eating, you know, bags of dried rice that came in on USAID ships. So commerce begins there, and commerce is what we have to encourage, and commerce is only going to happen if you have healthy equines in this particular country. So here's Market Day and Cabaret. There's a lot of food. No trucks. It all came in on their backs. This is just a day in the country at the market. One thing you'll notice about Haiti, I've never been to the moon, but I assume that that's about what the surface of the moon looks like. It's been stripped and denuded. It's been overused. People are selling charcoal, which is in the bags there on the back of the donkeys. I call this my hubs of hell photo. I've never been hotter, sweatier, or more distressed than I was spending a day working in a donkey market or a charcoal market with these donkeys. It's probably 110 degrees there. They have no water, no shade, and we're trying to do what we can do. So it's really, really eye-opening, but it's not cruel. We do people and animals no service by gratuitous, ill-informed criticism and saying, those people are cruel. They're not. We need to understand the conditions under which they have to work. We need to understand the extent of their poverty. We need to recognize their strength, their necessities, their dignity, and their pride. Part of that comes from having a healthy animal. Harness stores. I was sent there. I did another couple of trips down there to work with their veterinarians, who, amazingly, they were nice, good, smart people with wonderful academic training that they had gotten in Cuba. Haiti had a contract with Cuba. So we could communicate because I could speak enough Spanish and they could speak enough Spanish. I don't speak Creole or French, and they don't speak English. So, but They have wonderful clinical knowledge, no clinical skills. Something as simple as saying, look, we've got to put this forceps all the way through the saddle sore to get things cleaned up and packed up and opened. Realizing it will never get better if we don't address nutrition. So it becomes a double-edged problem. How many of you have quinoa in your salad periodically, or have a little quinoa salad, you know? It's $6 a pound at Whole Foods these days, $6 or $8 a pound. In Haiti, they have developed a quinoa that doesn't grow at high altitude, it grows at sea level. It's a nice export product. And these women have brought in their bags of quinoa on the back of their donkeys and on their heads to the dustiest, dirtiest little mill I've ever seen. It's healthy, it's wonderful, high protein, easy to grow, too expensive to eat. They can't feed their kids high protein quinoa because they can get $4 a pound for it on the market. So you get into a real tug of war here. What's going to help here? And helping the animals in this case might help a little bit, but there's a bigger problem. So next time you have a little quinoa, say hello to Haiti. Owning a donkey or a horse can make a difference. It releases women and children from burdens. Most of the horses that we see are cared for by women and children because dad's out working in the field or doing something else. It can increase family income up by 500%. Well, that's from $15 to $25, but it's still family income. It gives the woman, the kids, some recognition, and it really helps with family stability. Over the next decade, the population of working animals will really double and not going down. So here's a question we get a lot. Do my good intentions help? If I send you money, what happens? You know, is it worthwhile to do tetanus vaccines, rabies vaccine, euthanasia, early treatment, parasite control? This is a mass euthanasia. That's me in the pit there. We had four of them to put down because there's a cultural bias against euthanasia, not to mention a bias. There's no backhoes. In this case, there was. But I euthanized four animals that afternoon. It was pretty grim. But you can make a difference, and you can treat them with respect and teach people that, no, this animal is way too sick, way too hard to use. So again, why do we need to care? Human life all over the world relies on these animals. We depend on them, and they, of course, depend on us. Animal welfare is our concern, but it's really family welfare. Diseases, accidents, injury treatments are essential, yet there's very little veterinary support. It's a wide open world, folks, if you want to go be a charity veterinarian, if you can afford it. So at the end of my trip to Haiti, a friend of mine and I and Shelley sat down and said, we've got to make a program for equine practitioners who are interested in this sort of work. And we did. We came up with the Equitarian Initiative. And these are just some scenes from what we're going to talk about here. What the hell is an equitarian? Did you catch my last name? My family used to have a little dictionary company. And they really did, my great-great-uncles. We got no money from it, but we were allowed to make up one word a year. So that's what we do. Merriam's Unofficial Dictionary of Veterinary Technology describes an equitarian as this, one who serves equids with compassion and whose only reward is their improved health and welfare. So I'll take that as my word. So we decided that the way to get equine involvement or equine practitioners involved and engaged in this was to set up a workshop. How do we train vets for work in the, you can't just go, you can, but you shouldn't just go and show up and say, well, hi, my ultrasound's at the airport, but I'll do something. No. So we set up workshops where they can see, diagnose, and treat real patients under direct supervision of local veterinarians, local guidance, and with your own knowledge of anatomy, physiology, antimicrobials, and things like that. So we set up these workshops, and we go to these with my partner. We have a partner in Mexico at UNAM, Dr. Mariano Hernandez Gil, who is a saint, just a machine. He works, but he sets these up in these little mountain towns, coastal towns, wherever, where there's no veterinary care, and we go for a week. And in a week, we'll see 300 patients. And we do guided surgeries, we do whatever needs to be done, shoeing, saddles. We set up a collaboration. This was the key right here. I'm enough of a blabbermouth, I knew a lot of people. Most of these humane organizations do not, have not ever worked together. They're competitive, they're competing for donor dollars. They lose track of the fact that we're all doing the same thing. So Mariano and I got them together. We had seven organizations and one workshop in Mexico. And this year we'll be on our, almost our 20th workshop. But it's not in Mexico, but we have these organizations saying, yeah, we'll help. Donkey Sanctuary, largest equine charity in the world, $40 million foundation or whatever. That, I mean, unbelievable. There's UNAM, the University of Mexico, AAP Foundation, World Horse Welfare, HSVMA, HSUS, and all these others. It's just amazing. But we had collaboration. And we brought everybody together in one room, and then we'd set up a triage area for our daily clinics. And they come in and get triage. They get to send parasitology or dentistry or musculoskeletal or whatever they had need. We had boarded surgeons, boarded internists, boarded parasitologists. We had, you'll see in a minute, we've had amazing staff people here. We had veterinarians who volunteered from all over the world. We gave veterinary students from the Dominican Republic and Mexico clinical experience that they don't get. We give you clinical experience you don't get. All you have to do is show up. We'll let you do anything you think you're capable of doing. Here I am. This picture just to me says collaboration. This guy here on the right is Ramiro Calderon. He's a boarded surgeon in Mexico City, works on the highest level jumpers and all this kind of stuff. Once he came on board on my team, and he and I are seen working together, it became cool. We had Mexican practitioners jumping out of the woodwork to come and work on our clinics. It was just wonderful. And that's what you have to do. It was their clinic, not ours. We were just the laborers. So again, give back. You really can make a difference. I want to go back to the definitions again. Because Equitarians are healers. Healers are what's going to change the world. We have these two simple words are our job description as equine veterinarians. They describe all of us by uniting us into a shared purpose and beyond all the differences we construct between ourselves, we have a common task. Healers, sources of hope. If we see ourselves in this way, the complexity we imagine becomes the simplicity we are. So remember that. You have a job. You have a mission. Community education, to get back to reality, begins with children. So in all of our projects, we have children engaged. These two young women are professional sociologists from the University of Mexico who traveled with us. And we help them come up with a coloring book in Spanish, picture games, how to care for your burro. And it's just a wonderful book, wonderful thing. But the important thing is that this is generational. Also, it signals we're here for you. We're here for the long term. We're not just coming for tomorrow or next week. So this is what it often comes down to. You work on the least of these animals. I've worked on world champions. I've worked on all these big name horses over years at different times. This is where I get the most kick and the most pride. It's where your soul meets the reason you became a veterinarian and who you really are. And the word equitariano is the same in Spanish as it is in English, as in Arabic. It's equitarian. Everybody knows. Oh, yeah. Did I say they were wheelchairs? You know, there is no ADA in Mexico, Americans with Disability Housing or anything else. This gentleman came to us on his burro. He rode for 2 hours. I'll talk a little bit. The two people helping him there in scrub shirts are Mexican veterinarians who trained in the U.S. as well. They're wonderful people. They're some of our frontline people. And they called me over and said, Jay, we got a problem here. This donkey's got a saddle sore, and the guy won't get off. Well, I came from this side. I said, well, come around here, and we'll see why. Do you see why he didn't get off? So, whoops, back up here. That's what's important. So he and his grandson rode 2 hours to get to us. We took care of his saddle sore. We wormed him. We took his teeth, trimmed his feet, and sent him on his way. Excuse me. I've never smoked a day in my life until I got off the plane the other day. Okay, so there's no better definition of equine welfare than helping our friends. I think the term welfare has gotten kind of a misuse over the years because it usually, in our country, implies cruelty. Oh, the welfare folks are going to come and take your horse or your dog away because you're not feeding them. Welfare, to me, is a different story in the third world. Welfare isn't because they don't care, it's because they don't have. People ask me, Jay, how the hell did you ever afford all this stuff? Do you ever work? And that's the answer to that. Yeah. Last 5 years of my practice, I was in the top 2% of money earners. When I come home, I work. We had a wonderful, profitable practice, and we still traveled internationally 2 times a year. You can do it. You don't have to sell the house or the car or the kids. You can do this as much as you want. I'll sell the kids if you want. But anyway, we took plenty of time for quality time. You come home from one of these trips, and you're washed out emotionally, physically. It's time to go get a little quality time. I want you to remember one of my favorite authors, a guy named St. Paul, second letter of the Corinthians, who said, the relief of others ought not to impoverish you. There should be a certain equality. Your plenty at the present time, and believe me, you have plenty, should supply their needs, so their needs, their surplus may one day supply your needs, with equality as a result. All right, here's project number 3. We go to Morocco. I did not set this project up. Some woman in Boston, Amy Ben Bishop, set it up 100 years ago this year. It's a hospital in Fez, Morocco, which is the oldest continuously inhabited city in Africa. It's in North Africa. It's beautiful. It's got everything you'd think. There's market goods, rugs, food, goes on for miles. Every single item has to be brought in on the back of a donkey or a horse. No motorized vehicles allowed in the Medina. So we have a built-in population of overworked, plodding along old donkeys and mules that really, really are supporting their families. Again, I keep saying 15 bucks a day, that's probably what it is, 20 bucks. But they carry unbelievable loads through the Medina. So she decided to put up a veterinary hospital in 1920. And I'm on the board of directors. I'm a surgeon at the hospital. I go teach a surgery course every year, except the last 2 years. But we provide free veterinary care for these animals. It's wonderful. And it's a totally different kind of approach than what we do in the Dominican Republic, where we work basically with our hands, our stethoscopes, minimum of instruments. here at this hospital, there's the main entrance there, and you can see the young child who brought her mule in for a little work. Here at this hospital, we have digital x-rays, digital ultrasound. We have a lab that's the equivalent of any lab I've ever had in a private practice. We have stuff. We have the toys. I helped them build a new surgery room. We have hydraulic tables. We got everything. We can do anything that we need to do. And that's the other type of charity, because we're training a boatload of veterinarians. These students are mostly from Glasgow. Glasgow has realized that they don't have a caseload in Glasgow, so they farm their students out to the Fondouk. We have 40 horses in stalls, or 40 animals in stalls every day, and another 30 or 40 walking through the door. We need help. We have a dormitory. They pay a tuition. We feed them. We take care of them. And they see more stuff in a month than they'll see in 10 years. And we treat them right. This guy here, I'm sorry, my pointer doesn't seem to work, but the guy here now is the current new director of the Fondouk. We hired him. This picture, he was a student. He's one of my surgery students, known him for quite a few years. We hired him after we sent him to Peru to get boarded in surgery. So he'll be the first boarded surgeon in Africa. The woman standing next to my gray hair is Dr. Gigi Kay, who is a legend in the world of animal welfare, equine welfare, who is retired as the director of the hospital. This guy here is Sami Hussein, who is probably the best veterinary technician I've ever dealt with. And the rest of these kids, a mix of Glaswegians, one or two Americans, and the rest Moroccans. So we see real cases every day. This hernia, I show you this just because sometimes you do futile stuff, but the black marks here are firing scars, where they've taken a red hot iron trying to reduce the hernia. Well, that'll help. So we did a 3-hour surgery one day and got it reduced about half, put in Marlex mesh. But it's totally different than working in the jungles of Samana, where we have everything here that we can do. Different type. I want to show you the interns who are now in charge of the veterinary profession that I've dealt with. There's Ahmed, and the woman on the left is taking the picture is Gita. She's up at the University of Morocco, Marrakesh, as an equine clinician. The others are students that I've gotten to know over the years. The guy in the middle back there is in France. On this end, this is my very first intern in Massachusetts Equine Clinic. She's now the head of medicine at Tufts University, Melissa Maison. This is now my second or third intern, who is now the head of my old practice. This is Rose Nolan Walston, who's senior clinician at Penn, and Mary Rose Parody, who is now the retired director of medicine at Tufts. The point is that there have been some awfully good people involved with some awfully good projects, and it's not a cast-off sort of a situation. Let's go back to Morocco now, just for the heck of it. The loads these animals carry are tremendous, just tremendous. This is a refrigerator, and it's going up to the third floor of a hotel. I wouldn't believe it if I hadn't seen it. The young woman on the little donkey is getting the family's water for the day. The young woman on the right is getting the family's water for the day. Her donkey's dead, so she's bringing it herself. This is the reality that we face all the time. In Morocco now, if a donkey that's under our care, under our umbrella, dies and leaves the family bereft, we will go to a souk and buy a new one. But you have to pay us back. So we loan you the money to buy a new one, which is wonderful. Preserves everybody's dignity and gets a job done. But this is the reality of why these kids, or why these animals are important. Every once in a while you get to meet royalty. This is Princess Anne. She's the patron of World Horse Welfare, patroness of World Horse Welfare. She's a world-renowned equestrian. I got to meet her at a symposium in London, and I gave her a belt buckle made from this donkey's shoe with a story of the donkeys in Fez, and the, you know, and she was very, very sympathetic. She'd been very supportive of our cause. So you got to do some fun things every once in a while, too. But again, the pressures on these families are immense. No matter how hard your life is, I can't say it's nothing, but it's not as hard as theirs. Caring people have to get involved, and that's why I'm here today. Involvement can be as simple as sending money to some charity, or it can be packing up your bags and signing up and going to one. Many millions of people rely on these animals, and they are sustainable. There's that word. They are sustainable. They reproduce if you give them a chance. They do very little environmental damage. I wouldn't say no environmental damage, but they are green. If a donkey dies, harshly, he gets recycled. He becomes fertilizer. If a tractor dies because it has a broken part, it becomes a pile of rust in the desert. So they are really important. This guy's carrying gasoline to some field. Now, this is going to be fun. Let's see if this works. Here. Yeah. I've learned an awful lot, things I didn't learn in school. And I'd like to show you something as we wind things up here. Any idea? This is a dyspneic donkey presented gasping for breath. And they said it only happened overnight. So if I didn't have a fiber optic endoscope, which I did have, I'm not sure I could have diagnosed this. Anybody got any ideas? Sing it out, or not. That's a leech. He drank out of a dirty puddle right in front of his owner's house. And the leech got stuck in his throat and just about choked him to death. Now, I asked Cora this morning, didn't I ask you how you would treat that? How would you treat that? No, the leech. The leech.
Oh, you didn't ask me
that. Oh, you didn't? Okay. Oh, it must have been Morgan. Somebody. Anyway, how would you treat that leech? With what? No, this is a donkey. You're going to need that hand the rest of your life. Number two, it won't fit. So how else would you treat him? Oh, yeah, of course, RJ. Yeah, put a cigarette. Okay. Of course. Yeah. All right, you've got an endoscope passed up there. You can pass a biopsy needle through an endoscope and inject him with ivermectin right on the spot. Killed him. But these are things that, again, I would have never thought of that. So back to what we're talking about, compassion, altruism, good medicine. It's all one, really. You can't have one without the other. And whoever is kind to the creatures of God shall himself receive kindness. That's an Arabic saying that we had plastered on the wall of our hospital. I think it's fabulous. Gives me hope. In Peru, during COVID, and I'll finish off with some of this, we have a project for the animals that carry tourists and packs up to Machu Picchu. Well, in COVID, there's no tourists. The animals are starving, the people are starving. We took our budget and sent food to the people and the animals. Again, it's part of that big picture, that rollover that says, you can do something. And why do we do it? We're giving back to the world. We're giving back to our profession. I'm giving back to a wonderful old K-State in my profession. We can affect fundamental change without governmental interference. None of this is government done. It's all private. We can go one-on-one. We speak for those who have no voice, like this little guy and his horse. I want to wrap it up a little bit now with a movie, kind of sums things up. I don't know if we can turn up the sound on this. Oh, there. I think we got it. There are projects going on all over the world, and I just want to review some of them, see what's going on. That's Mariano, my friend from Mexico, extending his reach. We don't do this for money. We don't do this for glory. I got a nice little statue out of it, and I'm thrilled beyond belief. But this is what we do. There's Morocco with all these mules coming in every day. Every one of them is a valuable asset. And here's our students. The girl in the pink shirt is now a veterinarian. I'm a veterinarian. The other woman is now a veterinarian. This is a Mongolian veterinarian, by the way. This is in the United States. This is in Havasu, Arizona. There's problems down there too. We go to Indian reservations. Wherever you go, you find horses that have gotten themselves into car wrecks. It's awful. Horses are building the world, but they're being run over. Carrying incredible loads. This is the Havasu Indian Reservation again. We call that our Dominican pickup. You don't have a load of horse of fish in there before too long. Help a horse, help a family. Yeah, horseless in Africa. A little blind donkey friend. A little girl. Selling oranges in Santo Domingo. Russian tourist thinks that's a good look. Packing out of the Grand Canyon. Education is really the key. Your education and theirs. Critical. That's the thing we can give. Friend Tom Jurgens teaching in Mongolia. Another friend in Africa. Steve O'Grady teaching some young Dominican how to tack a shoe on without an upset. These are things we can do. These are skills that need to be shared. Whoops, sorry. Oh, okay. We'll move on. I want to leave you with one thought that my friend Jose Luis Velasquez from Mexico said, no trabajes para llenar tu cartera. Trabaja para nutrir tu espíritu. I think you understand that. Don't work just to fill your wallet. Work to nurture your spirit. He's been a help to us in building these veterinary teams all over the country. No amenities, no facilities, no problem. A week in the field can really do something for you. Outreach and education for vets, caregivers, extends our reach. Oh, yeah. K-State was there all the way along. This is in Costa Rica. This is one of our Equitarian workshops. And this is where you can get yourself involved if you want to do it. You can apply to become a member of one of our workshops and go to Costa Rica for a week or Nicaragua or Mexico, depending on where it is, and learn field medicine. Learn how to get dentistry done by hanging six horses on the soccer goal of the local village and doing teeth. Learn how to work on saddles so they don't create sores. And yes, extend your reach. These are working equids. There are a lot of questions and we'll answer them in a minute. Shelley and I are going to fund at least one, maybe two scholarships every year to an Equitarian workshop. And if you're interested, you can contact me and we'll get this figured out, how to do it. It's an application process. We have a lot of people who want to go, but I think I have some influence. So, and we would do it for a vet student or an intern. You go to Mexico, Costa Rica, Dominican Republic. You have to give us a full report, and you have to give a report to your class when you get done. They call me the Donk Doc, and even though I've passed retirement age, the work continues. Those are the two organizations. And there's how you get in touch with us. I think if we have time for questions, I'm happy to answer them. Meanwhile, thank you very much for your indulgence.